media and entertainment industry grew to $23.9 billion in 2018. That's a growth of 13.4% over the previous year. This according to EY and FICCI's report that was released earlier today. While the television business continues to retain the pole position, it comes as no surprise that the real growth push is coming from the digital segment, which is likely to overtake film and entertainment in 2019 and print by 2021. Growing at 42% year-on-year, the digital media segment now commands 20% of the total advertising spend. Digital subscription in 2018 has grown by a whopping 262%, and EY estimates that the number of digital-only consumers in India will double from 2.5 million today to 5 million in 2021. Multiple digital platforms, curated content creation, and improved data bandwidth are changing the way that India consumes its content. A study by Omidyar Network shows that the average Indian spends 30% of the time on mobile phones on entertainment, second only to social media. But in terms of data, over 70% is used on entertainment. So hello and welcome to CNBC TV 18's special show, Eye on India. I'm Shereen Bhan. And the question that we're asking today is, the media and entertainment industry in India ready to cater to a billion screens? And what will this shift to digital mean for the traditional media business? Joining me on the show today, Gaurav Gandhi, director and business head at Amazon Prime Video India. Also with me, Nachiket Panthvaidya, CEO at Alt Balaji and Group CEO Balaji Telefilms. And Ashish Pervani, partner and leader for media and entertainment at EY India. Gentlemen, appreciate you joining us here on the program. Ashish, I'll start with you because the future clearly is with Nachiket and Gaurav, so I'll get to them in just a second. But let me get a status check from you on what the industry looks like, the good, bad and the ugly. What are the headlines?
So I think the clear headlines are about any media with direct-to-customer connect is really where the money is shifting. This is seen across online gaming, which grew at over 59%, and of course digital, which grew at 42%. On the other hand, you have the traditional media, which have seen a bit of sluggishness. They've not grown as much as these new media, radio, print, and out of home, which are all in the sub 10% growth ranges. And in the middle, you have, of course, film and television, large segments doing very well on the back of digitization and export of content. So I think there's growth all over. Every segment's doing well. But the driver, the real crux, is really about going direct to customer. And media that are enabling that movement direct to customer, I think they're taking the advantage of the current situation.
Okay, so let's talk about the future then. And as you pointed out, that's where the story is headed, so to speak. So Gaurav Gandhi, I'll start by asking you, I mean, for instance, give me a sense of the kind of growth that you've been able to deliver at Amazon Prime. And what does the future really look like, given the fact that this report clearly does seem to suggest and highlight the fact that people are willing to pay for content?
Yeah, Shereen, I think the last 2 years of Prime Video and Prime have been amazing. We've now gone far deeper and wider than we started off with. Amazon Prime is enjoyed in over 1,000 cities and towns in the country. The tailwinds of the industry are well known, and that's the ubiquitous devices, cheaper data, big shift to connected screens, all of that. But I think the big driver from our end, what we're seeing is in our investment into content. We have, we're doubling our number of original shows. We have 30 shows in development. We've gone into 8 local languages in terms of our content. We've got 3, language UIs with Hindi, Tamil, Telugu. And we're going far deeper on that front. So we're seeing the tailwinds of the industry coupled with our content, our distribution, our regionalization initiatives, and all are fueling our growth at Prime and Prime Video. And the fact, I would just like to add to that, is the fact that Prime as a program itself is so unique, with best of shopping and video coming to one. That's great value for customers, so that makes it even better for the customers.
You've thrown in your sales pitch right there, Gaurav, but a quick follow-up question, because you talked about how 30 shows are currently in production,
yeah,
and you're also looking at delivering content across different languages. 8 languages is what you're focusing on currently. But what about spends? I mean, how much are you now budgeting as far as content creation is concerned? And you talked about all the various tailwinds that are driving growth, but what about headwinds? Would the big headwind in that sense for you be Netflix?
Yeah, so I think our thing on the one challenge one sees in this industry at this point is satiating the demand of the customer who's just hungry for even more. So as soon as we get our next season of our show out, they want another one and so on. So I think that is one thing. The other thing I think is it's the fact that it's a diverse market, and in that sense, creating content for each kind of customer in the local language and offering that to them is one challenge. And I think we have done a lot of work on that space, but there's more to be done, and we continue to do that.
You didn't bite my bait at all on Netflix. I thought I was going to be able to extract a little more than just a smile from you. But nevertheless, let me go across to Nachiketa. Nachiketa, I'm assuming you're not going to bite the bait either. So let me get a check from you on where things stand as far as Alt Balaji is concerned. And really, again, both in terms of the kind of content that you're likely to curate, and also this business of curating not just for India, but for the world, this business of exporting content out of India. What's the story looking like and the kind of opportunities that you see there?
Well, we've been having phenomenal success recently. We've done 5 times the revenue in your second year of operations as we would do in our first year. We are upwards of 10 million paying subscribers. And that has reinforced two parts of our theory. One is that original mass content seems to be being lapped up by mass India in a big way. That's one. Secondly, long-form content, which was in doubt about 2 years ago, seems to be the way to go, especially long-form series content. The third question that everybody always was skeptical about is, will Indians pay? And we believe that if you price a service at less than a rupee a day, you will see phenomenal uptake in mass India for that. So these three hypotheses of ours have got a tick mark against them. We are doing very well. We have a huge development pipeline. What we are not doing and what differentiates us from everybody else is that we are largely dependent on original series content. 95% of our content is stuff that we own. We want to monetize through subscription and not put ads on. We don't want to acquire movies. We don't have large libraries of English content. And that's what really sets us apart as being focused on that 200 to 250 million heavy internet video user. And we are well on our way to, you know, market leadership in that segment.
You know, you talked about revenues growing, and you also talked about the ability for consumers to pay at least a rupee or a little under a rupee a day. But what does that mean then in terms of the overlying profitability going forward, given the fact that your focus is going to be on creating original content, and given the competitive landscape, that means spending big bucks?
Well, actually, the content big bucks have to be complemented with marketing big bucks to acquire consumers. And it's turning out to be a play of building a huge library. We are right now at 35 shows. I think when we have 100 shows out on our service, we shall be seeing a huge inflow of marketing money to acquire those consumers. Right now, our library is a bit thin, and we feel that we are only one-third the way to really doing this huge big bang of acquiring consumers. So that's point one. Point two, I think in terms of profitability, and I've said this often on CNBC itself, is that we have got a cost base of about 150 to 160 crores every year. And we feel that if we've got, you know, 8 million paying subs who pay us at about 300 rupees a year or 200 rupees a year, depending on how this ARPU fluctuates internationally, that's what we are looking at. We are at a position to break even. So what we are trying to say here is that we want to run this as a business that actually delivers a break even and a profit someday. And it's not just, you know, deep sinkhole where somebody keeps putting in money and doesn't see the returns. We actually are seeing a growth in revenues. The first year we clocked about, you know, 7 crores. The first 2 quarters of the next year, we've done 3 times that already. And therefore, you know, we will be at a good level in terms of trying to recover our cost base, which is about 150 to 160 crores.
Okay, so you're hoping to turn profitable someday, at least get to the break-even point soon enough. But let me take the same question across to Gaurav. Gaurav, how are you looking at the ARPUs playing out? And I'll sort of extrapolate this or compare this to what the experience that we've seen as far as the telecom business is concerned. As we saw competition intensify in the telecom business, look at how ARPUs have fallen and fallen drastically now. In fact, almost halved over the last few years. So what does the story look like when you talk about ARPUs, especially given the fact that you're all vying for pretty much the same pie going forward?
I think we look at it slightly differently, Shereen. We look at working backwards from the customer and what customer is looking at. I think providing the customer the best selection and best value is what Amazon does. So if you look at our program on Prime, when we offer him the customer free shipping and quick delivery, and we offer video content, best of global and Indian, and music, and reading experiences, I think at $9.99 a month and or 129 a year or 129 a month, I think it's a great deal, and it's the best deal in town. And we believe that if you price, as you was mentioning this, if you price a service right, and you have great benefits, customer uptake will happen. And we are seeing that happening across, and our initiatives on distribution and localization are only adding to that. So we believe the opportunity is very large and very vast, and we're just getting started here.
Shereen, if I may interject onto basically, I think what is really a good indicator is the average prepaid loading that a telco consumer does today. So if you look at a prepaid, kind of buy on telco, they're between 50 and 80 rupees that everybody's loading onto, and that's what Mass India does. So I think if you are in asking your consumer to spend, 100 rupees or 200 rupees, you're still only addressing 20% of that prepaid consumer base, which is actually your mobile internet base. If your price points start getting more and more affordable and you are able to sachetize your offering, you're able to offer a 10 rupee product, a 15 rupee product, and a huge local library, I think that's when the mass market will truly open up. That's about a couple of years away, looking at how things are.
Well, that's interesting that you talk about the sachetization, even as far as this business is concerned. And that's going to be a trend to watch out for over the next few years, as you point out. But Ashish, there is absolutely no disagreement on the fact that we've seen consumption trends move only higher. The average India data user consumption has doubled from 4 to 8 GB per month between 2017 and 2018. You expect it to go to about 10 GB per month on an average in 2019. But to just pick up on the points that both Nachiket as well as Gaurav are making in terms of what we could expect in future trends, the sachetization, more local sort of content being created, the various pulls and pressures that you expect on the distribution side, the innovations there. What's the expectation now to drive and grow this market further?
So I think while you spoke about earlier about the number of people who are cord cutters and only watching digital, I think the big shifts will happen in people who are actually willing to pay for at least one OTT service a month. We estimated that number to be about 6 million subscribers in 2017. It's already jumped in our estimation to about 12 million subscribers today. And there's no reason why within 3 years that 12 million can't cross 30 to 35 million as well. On the other hand, I think the biggest possible driver of content consumption online is probably going to be the telco. I think in 2018, you've already had more than 200 million people consuming content through bundled packs and through telcos. And we see that moving to more than 375 million within 3 years. Now, that's going to increase the quantum of content consumption massively, in my expectation. So it's all about segmenting the market. You'll have the digital only, you'll have the tactical guys, and you'll have the bundled guys. And this is really all of which is going to drive the market in very different ways, because each segment has different content choices, different payment methods, and different expectations on how much they want to pay and how much they're going to consume. All of that's going to be very interesting. And honestly, none of us know how that's going to play out. It's all new for everyone. But I can assure you of one thing, it's going to be really exciting to see who gets there, whether sachet pricing will work or bundle pricing will work. I think the jury's out on that, but we'll see it happen over the next 2 years. And I think we should be happy we're alive at this time in this country, in the media and entertainment sector, just to see a complete revolution taking place in front of our eyes.
Well, on that note, we'll take a break. When we return, we continue our focus on the future for the media and entertainment industry. We're back in a moment on Eye on India.